Where and with whom do you feel safe? Who and what can you depend on? What makes you feel comforted? What builds trust? Empathy? When do you feel seen, heard, and understood? Hi, this is Sarah Russell, your Trends with Benefits microdose host, offering you snack-sized bites that are tools for transformation and mood boost. If you want the full meal, you can check out Kyle's macrodose episodes. Those are longer-formed episodes where he's interviewing interesting people doing good things out in the world. But for today's microdose episode, I'll be talking about how we can explore the care and comfort and satisfaction and pleasure of being securely attached to yourself. For me, there is a distinct difference in my body when somebody I love is off on an adventure and I'm going, have such a good time. Please send me photos. I want the pleasure report and I am going to miss you so much and I can't wait to see you when you get back. That's really different than when somebody I love is off somewhere and I'm going, why haven't you called? I texted you and you haven't responded. It's getting late. Where are you? Who are you out with? And I'm doing this thing where I'm scanning for danger and I'm worried that they're going to be doing something that's going to disrupt the relationship in some way. And I start feeling unsafe and I start feeling worried that I need to take care of myself in some way. And I'm doing all this worst case scenario planning. That's a really different feeling in my body. And part of that might have to do with object permanence. And object permanence comes from attachment theory, which was created by John Bowlby. And object permanence has to do with when you're a little teeny tiny baby and your caregiver leaves the room, that little teeny tiny baby you, does that baby believe that caregiver's going to come back? They've been taking such good care of me. I totally trust that they're going to come back to this dynamic, this relationship in some way. Or does little teeny tiny baby you freak out in some way, like completely shut down or start getting really anxious, start, you know, protesting in some way because they are not sure whether or not that caregiver's coming back. And that distinction is the difference between being securely attached and insecurely attached. And here's the thing. When we're babies, we are powerless and we need somebody to feed us and clothe us and change us and make sure we have a safe place to sleep and a shelter over our head. We are completely dependent on our caregivers for our basic survival needs. And so our powerlessness equals danger when we're babies. If somebody doesn't take care of us, we're screwed. Like, that's it. And so when we have caregivers that are fairly consistent, and I'm saying fairly consistent because as I go through this, I don't want all of the caregivers, like, it's hard to be a parent. It's hard to be a caregiver. You're going to make mistakes. That's fine. You're not going to mess your babies up too bad if you're trying, right? So this is like all of this with a grain of salt. Fairly, if a caregiver is fairly consistent, fairly reliable, fairly responsive, is really making sure that baby's needs are cared for, that baby is going to feel secure. But if we have a caregiver that's inconsistent, unreliable, unresponsive in some way or dangerous, then that baby is going to start developing coping strategies in order to deal with how dangerous the situation is, in order to deal with the fact that their powerlessness and that powerlessness equals danger. And we see this in all the classic responses, survival responses, right? Fight, flight, freeze, dissociate, fawn. So those survival responses to our powerlessness and to our danger get baked into our nervous system when we're very young, when we're pre-verbal. And then what happens is as we grow up, as we age, our powerlessness and danger diverge from one another. So now every time we're powerless, it doesn't necessarily mean we're in danger, but our nervous systems are reading it as if that's still true. And so then we start enacting all of our survival strategies as if every single time we're powerlessness, not getting our way, it doesn't go the way that we want, as if that's a dangerous situation. And in a future episode, I'll be talking about the different insecure attachment styles that can result from that, which is anxious attachment, avoidant attachment, or disorganized attachment. But for today, I really want to stay in this like yummy, safe, comforting place of what it means to be securely attached. Some of the ways that you might know you're securely attached or experiencing secure attachment is one, you enjoy being with other people. And that means there's trust, right? You trust that they have your well-being at heart. They trust that you have their well-being at heart. There's camaraderie. There's shared interest. You enjoy being with other people. Another way that secure attachment manifests itself is that you feel fine being dependent on other people, and other people are dependent on you. How did you feel when I asked that question? Like, how do you feel being dependent on other people? Do you ask for what you want? Do you ask for support? And who gets to call you and ask you for support? So are you willing to be committed to somebody else enough? Like, this is a sign of secure attachment, right? Like, yeah, I'm here for you. I've got you. And you also trust that people have got your back as well. Something else that manifests in secure attachment is this ability to self-soothe and self-regulate. So you can recognize your triggers. You know when you're being triggered. You recognize, like, oh, this is how I'm thinking. This is how I'm feeling. This is how I'm behaving. You know when you're off center. And you've also got some kind of centering practice, so you know how to bring yourself back on. And part of bringing yourself back on to center is the ability to pause, where you're getting rid of the urgency, you're getting rid of the immediacy, assuming that you're not in an unsafe situation, like assuming that you're in a triggered state, a historical trigger state, and there's not like current and present danger. You can pause so that you can respond to the situation instead of react. Another sign of secure attachment is during conflict, you are able to understand the other person's perspective, take responsibility for your part in it. You're able to apologize. You're willing to engage in some kind of problem solving. Now, in the middle of conflict, it's really easy to get triggered. It's really easy to get defensive and double down and try to defend our goodness. But there's a difference between like having a little bit of defensiveness and going full blown into, I'm the victim. Why are you attacking me? Now I feel powerless. Now I feel weak in some way. Or like swinging all the way to the other side and going full bore persecutor, where how dare somebody come after you? Now you're going to come after them twice as hard. How dare they hurt you? Now you're going to try to hurt them. Right? The secure attachment is like, oh, like we have a difference here. Something happened that one of us or both of us didn't like. And now I'm willing to engage in some kind of cooperative process around all of this. Again, like a lot of this is assuming cooperative relationships, right? I'm not talking about hierarchy. I'm not talking about people who are power playing or abusive. I'm assuming cooperation for all of this. The other thing that is a marker of secure attachment is you're good at transitioning from being around people to being by yourself and vice versa. You're good at being by yourself and then transitioning to being around people. So you enjoy your own company. You can have a good time with yourself. You're fine being alone with your thoughts. And you can be alone and then switch to being with other people where you enjoy their company. And then when you're with other people and then you transition to being by yourself, like you don't get too bummed out, right? Like it's okay to be a little sad to miss your friends. The performer in me knows there's always like this huge drop off. Like we've been performing together in the theater all week. We've been doing dress rehearsal. We've been teching. We've been in front of these huge audiences. And then when I'm by myself again after that, it is sad. But I know how to self-soothe and self-regulate through that, right? Another indication of secure attachment is having healthy boundaries. And so this isn't being too porous and it's not being too rigid. So an example of being too porous would be you overextend yourself, you excessively caregive. We define this as rescue, right? Doing more than your share or more than you want. You're overextending yourself as a way to try to make sure the other person like knows that you're worthwhile of their, you're worthy of their love and attention. So boundaries a little too porous where you're not actually holding your boundary. Then there's the flip side of that where your boundaries can get way too rigid where you've got such a wall up, such a guard up that you're not letting other people influence you. And as you're locked away in your tower, like with your battlements behind your moat, that means you're actually not able to give very much to the relationship either. So healthy boundaries mean you feel both connected and protected. That's Jessica Fern's language from Polysecure, a book I highly recommend and I will be talking about in a future podcast because it's great, y'all. It talks about the different attachment styles in relationship to consensual non-monogamy or kind of open relating style. But this idea of being both connected and protected. And so when we're feeling connected and protected, we can recognize that there's me, there's you, and there's us. And across that, there's some kind of respect, recognizing that we may have differences, but there's also going to be some kind of cooperation, some kind of sharing happening. So you can think about all of these questions, right? Do you enjoy being with other people? Do you feel comfortable having people depend on you? Do you feel comfortable having other people depend on you? Do you recognize your triggers? Can you self-regulate? How do you respond to conflict? Like, what's your mental, emotional, and physical state when you're in the middle of conflict? And do you need to soften your boundaries, or do you need to strengthen your boundaries in some way? Because as Prentice Hemphill says, boundaries are the distance at which I can love you and me simultaneously. And that's really what secure attachment is all about, right? Being able to love me and you simultaneously. And what does that dance look like? So secure attachment, we know, creates healthy relationships with higher levels of satisfaction. There's more trust. There's more empathy. There's more respect. And one of my favorite side effects of a secure attachment style is there's greater sexual satisfaction as well, including something, this term that I absolutely love, called sexploration. And sexploration is a term from Settlerman, Gesselman, and Moores, and they define it as the degree to which a person co-constructs a sex-positive, supportive, and safe environment with their partner. So by developing a secure attachment style with yourself, which can then translate across your relationships, you're going to have a better sex life. That alone is worth diving into some of these questions and exploring whether or not you would like to strengthen your secure attachment style in some way, because who knows what becomes available in this exploration, in this super sex positive space. If you're not experiencing secure attachment, don't start shaming yourself. Don't start shitting all over yourself. Like I said, I'm going to be talking about anxious, avoidant, and disorganized styles in future podcasts, because it's a tough world, y'all. And even when our caregivers were doing their best, it's likely that at some point they missed the mark in some way, because that's what happens. We're all in these individual bodies with individual needs, and we can't necessarily always know what's the best thing for everybody else around us. And you know, if you experience more harm or more trauma or more danger in your life, like, just be easy with yourself that you've developed these coping strategies as a way to try to keep yourself safe from danger. But a secure attachment style is available. We can practice pieces of it, even if we can't have it all the time in all of our relationships. We can have glimpses of it. We can have moments of it. We can celebrate those successes. So just be easy with yourself wherever you are on the spectrum, from secure to insecure attachment. And know that with practice, with repetition, with intention and support, that you can actually have more satisfying relationships. Thank you so much for listening. If you enjoyed this, please leave a review on Apple Podcasts or anywhere else that you listen. Some of you have been leaving me reviews, and I'm a words of affirmation person, and I just absolutely love reading them. They completely make my day. And it's also really helpful to show the head mushrooms at MUD WTR that we should keep doing this podcast, that y'all want it, that y'all like it. So those reviews are really helpful. Also, we have a YouTube channel where you can go and watch me do this podcast, and it's super helpful if you leave comments there. You can also check out trendswithbenefits.com for all of our written content, and you can sign up for our newsletter and get your weekly dose of all the good that we offer. And if you would like some extra support in your relationships, you can send a voice memo to podcast@mudwtr.com describing to me what you're struggling with, what you're curious about, and I would be happy to offer you some free coaching through this podcast. And you can also send a voice memo, try to keep it to like 1 to 2 minutes with this one, where you tell me your favorite way to drink your MUD WTR. And if we play that on this podcast, we'll ship you a free MUD WTR mug. So be sure to include your address with that email. And again, you can send that to podcast@mudwtr.com. May you find peace. May you find pleasure. May you find purpose. May you find presence. Take care.